Hey, you guys, I'm back with another video. So we're going to dig deeper into this mystical mystery. And like I said before, guys, there is a person who claims that David Neville was not at the home at the time of Michelle's murder and then later changed his story. Like I said, if that person was not home himself, how would he know if Damon Neville was there or not?
Late that night, he did hear a strange noise that jolted him out of bed.
But it was an unusual noise, like somebody was being thumped on the floor, dragged down the steps or something. It's like boom, 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 and it paused, and then boom, boom. And then that's when I came to the door and listened, and I ain't hear nothing else. So I just let it go, and then that was all I heard. And that's what I told the police, too.
This is not Damon Neville, by the way, guys. If you clearly can hear, this is a man that witnessed another crime happening in his apartment building, and I was just using this as an example. This was late at night, as the man exclaimed, and he said he did hear a boom, boom, boom. He heard some noise, and this was a man that was not even in the unit. However, he lived upstairs from these victims. So how is it that Mystical was home and he didn't hear any boom, boom, boom? If you guys pay attention, like I said, I am a big fan of Mystical, the rapper, and his music. However, I am not a fan of Michael Tyler, the person behind Mystical. If you guys know any of Mystical's songs, Mystical claims in one of his songs that he was manic as fuck. And I will be adding that to another video. However, it will not be played here. I want to get to the facts and keep this as sweet as possible and short. Now, Mystical claimed that he was manic. Was he diagnosed by a doctor? Who told him that he was manic? And why is this man using such a big word as manic? Beats me, but it is a red flag. Pay attention.
Bipolar disorder is a complex mood disorder characterized by dramatic mood swings between poles of mania and depression. But what exactly is mania and what are the symptoms? Mania is an abnormally elevated mental state that's characteristic of bipolar disorder, typified by extreme exhilaration, energy, and euphoria. However, mania can quickly spiral out of control, resulting in anger, irritability, and aggression, as well as impulsive and reckless behavior. The hallmark symptoms of mania involve an unusually elevated, euphoric, or expansive mood with markedly increased energy and decreased need for sleep, along with loud, excessive, and rapid talkativeness, with the person jumping suddenly from one thought to another. Another mania symptom is racing thoughts, which involve unwanted and often unrelated thoughts or memories that may include past conversations, song lyrics, parts of television shows or movies, or random repetitive phrases that sufferers are powerless to stop. Constant restlessness, being easily distracted, having difficulty concentrating, and an inability to make decisions are also typical symptoms of mania. Grandiose behavior is another common mania symptom. Sufferers may develop unrealistic self-confidence and extreme arrogance. They may feel and act virtually invincible as they make their extravagant plans and incessantly pursue unfeasible goals. While manic symptoms may often include charming and charismatic behavior, it's not uncommon for this behavior, with its accompanying sense of well-being and positive energy, to suddenly change to hostility and aggression that may include verbal or physical assaults. Impulsive behavior, typically with no regard for consequences, is also a symptom of mania. For example, a person may suddenly decide to quit a job, go on a spending spree, gamble away their savings, indulge in substance abuse, or drive recklessly. This tendency toward involvement in potentially dangerous activities may also combine with heightened sexual desire, which is also a common symptom of mania, and may result in risky or inappropriate sexual behavior.
Now, Mystical claimed himself, guys, this is not anything that I'm alleging. It is indeed on the record. He claimed that he was manic as fuck. So the word that he used was manic as fuck means that his disease is really rapid right now. As you guys know, Mystical was charged with sexual assault and rape and extortion, and also charged in another rape. He is also accused of beating on all of his baby mamas. Some of them got him locked up, some of them didn't. and he had to register as a sex offender. If you can see, Mystical's behavior is erratic and that of someone who is suffering with manic episodes. Let's continue. Now, if you guys were paying attention and you watched the live video, you can see Mystical's body language is definitely off in this video. He has done plenty of interviews for different radio stations, TV programs, and the other. However, when he is asked these questions about his sister's murder, his body language becomes very animated, as I stated before. Mystical was asked having questions by Vlad. He began scratching his face. He began animating the actual incident to where when he found his sister, as turning around like somebody was really behind him. This is an episode of Mania. And he expressed that in this interview right before our very eyes.
When a person lies, he cannot help it but relieve it by scratching particular parts of his face. When we lie, our body feels uneasy, and this makes us feel anxious. The autonomic nervous system kicks in to relieve our anxiety. Then the fight or flight response activates. This lessens the blood to areas of the body which can still function with less blood, like our facial skin. The result is itchiness or slight irritation on our face.
If you guys go take a look back at the Vlad interview with Mystical, he did, however, scratch his face and he remained very animated. And this is a red flag again, guys. He's clearly lying in this interview. However, let's keep going. Now, I watch crime shows and I look at the news constantly. And when a man is being charged for murdering a woman or murdering anybody, they will not speak to anyone. Now, we all know that Damon Neville was charged with the murder of Michelle Tyler. And then after the trial, he was later dismissed from the case and the charges were dropped against him. If he really killed Michelle, in my opinion, guys, he would have never interviewed or sat down with anyone for a YouTube video. He would have kept the truth inside and died with it. However, Damon Neville did sit down with Murder Master's YouTube channel and he did an interview. I did splice it up and I just want you guys to listen to what Mr. Neville had to say versus what Mystical has to say. And then you guys just make your determination. But as I promised, we are going to dig deep, deep, deep because that rabbit hole runs that way. Let's go, guys. And I just wanted to add one more thing, guys. Mystical was very arrogant, if you guys were really paying attention, to say that his sister was found with his promotional Not That Nigga t-shirt on when she was found strangled and stabbed to death in her neck 16 times, nearly decapitated and raped. But he states to Vlad, she was found with my Not That Nigga promotional t-shirt on. That is of arrogance and an episode of Mania. He was having a Mania episode right on Vlad TV. Right in front of our very eyes.
What went down with the police?
Yeah, it's all good, man. First let me put it out there that, not only was I involved in that shit, but I was using drugs at the time, too. I mean, if you got in your possession just a plethora of drugs, of course, as a youth, I was like 19, 20, 21 or some shit like that. I've used that shit. I loved it. It was the shit. But it had my mind framed to a point where I didn't give a shit about nothing else except that money and getting high. You know what I'm saying? Pushing that shit. So to kind of give you a little bit on the police shit, man. Like I said, a lot of this shit has touched me, but a lot of the people have been either convicted of some shit or dead or in jail for life. So we ain't dropping no names, but there was a situation, man, where I didn't know that I was dealing with a police officer until I got arrested and went to jail and saw the dude who just dropped me 280 pounds a week. And he was like... Oh, shit, hold up. What have you done? I got it. And he called somebody and they sent the money and they got me out. You know what I'm saying? It was just like, I was like, fuck, okay. You know, I mean, I had no clue this dude. I was in the fucking precinct being booked. And he just happened to pass and say, hold up, what he done? You know, and he paid, you know, he called whoever he called and they paid my bond and got me out. You know what I'm saying? And I never heard another situation, another peep about that particular situation. So, to go a little further, with that said, when shit really got crazy was, you know, my girl was killed. And I didn't, like I said, I knew from the arrest that this dude was the police now. So now I'm dealing with this cat. And some shit went on, man. And you know, I fucked around and took some shit that I wasn't supposed to take because of a I ain't going to say a disagreement. It was because of you know, he handled me bad. You know what I'm saying? We was in a predicament where we was in a parking lot with a lot of people. And he's sitting in this badass whip with this chick. And, you know, I'm going to the vehicle saying, man, come on, look, make the drop. It's just not the place for this shit. And he telling me, motherfucker, fuck that. You know, this and that. You working for me, da-da-da-da. So, you know, after a couple of times and insulting my manhood and integrity and talking to me stupid in front of this female, I just got pissed and said, fuck that. And did some shit and took some shit that didn't belong to me. I mean, some of it was supposed to be for me, but I mean, when I got the bag, I was like, oh, shit. I was like, fuck. You know what I'm saying? I was like, I really didn't understand the magnitude of the situation because I was just focused on my world. You know what I'm saying? I didn't give a shit about who else was involved or whatever. But once you see that big picture, you know that's that oh, shit moment. Like, I fucked up. You know what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
It's just crazy because I had no clue the amount of police who was involved with this shit. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, that's the corruption is deep, man. And I mean, it was all about the dollar, of course. You know, that's all it was about. They didn't give a shit about nothing else. It was money.
Yeah, just you know, it's a rare thing.
That's it, man. I mean, you know, and that's the case with a lot of shit. To these days, even, you know, when you look around at the political situation, they don't give a shit about the people. I mean, if they do, they fooled me. You know what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, everybody flying in jets and all this old different shit, while the people who paying all the money and paying taxes 3-4 times over from shit they work for, you know, they're struggling. While all of the big wigs flying in jets and taking their broads to islands and all this old type of shit, you know, but it is what it is. That's a whole other conversation, you know. But the political corruption for the police, man, that shit is like historical. They even have a few documentaries on the corruption of police in New Orleans. I've seen a few. And I was like, God damn, I was right in the midst of that shit. You know what I'm saying? But glad I didn't get caught up to the point where I had to go, you know, sit down for 40 years for somebody else's shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because initially, didn't they, they were trying to charge you?
Well, they did actually charge me with the murder because, you know, it was, like I said once again, the shit is so crazy and it goes so many different directions. What happened was when I got to the location of the crime scene, my mother called me and said, come home now. And I was like, shit, your house or mine? You know, and she was like, yo, you know, uptown. So I was like, all right. So, you know, when I went, everybody was standing outside, and I saw everybody except for my girl. And so I kind of put it together. You know, you can look at the scene and kind of see if she ain't there, then something fucking happened. So I jump out the vehicle and try to run to the door. They tackled me. So the two officers that tackled me, they took me into a hotel. You know, they just whipped me in the car and took me off. Now, I had no clue that these dudes was a part of whatever the fuck they was a part of. You know what I'm saying? So when I get to the interrogation office, they handcuff me to the table. They fucking, you know, I'm high as fuck. I'm high as fuck. I was coked out. I've been snorting coke and shit and smoking blunts and dirty blunts and shit. But I was still aware of my surroundings. But so they took me in there. They handcuffed me to the table and went to telling me the first thing they asked me was, where is the dope? Now, they didn't ask me shit about the girl until I fucking denied having the dope. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I don't know. They beat me up, punching me in my face, kicking me in my fucking chest. My fucking face swole up. I could barely talk. You know, they beat the shit out. But they had me in there for 8 hours, beating my ass, all behind the drugs. And then somewhere along the line, they went to asking me about the situation. You know, and I was like, man, I ain't do that shit. And they was like, pop, pop, beat the piss out of me. Because I really had no clue to what the fuck was going on until they said something to me, because I still had no clue. Because at the first point, my girl was riding around with my cousin in a brand new Mercedes that her husband had just purchased. So she wasn't even at the crib. You know what I'm saying? So she wasn't even supposed to be home. So I had no clue, really, of what the fuck was going on. But I still was kind of curious, because why everybody else here? And, you know, but anyway, so they started getting, whipping my ass. They beat me up and shit, asking me what a dope. And then they started telling me situations like, you did this, huh? And I was like, no, I ain't do it. Ah! And they choked me out and had a gun in my head and all this old shit and say, you fucking did it. And me, as a 20-something-year-old, you know, I'm like, fuck this shit. I'm trying to live. These motherfuckers want to hear something. I'm going to tell them what they want to hear. I say, okay, yeah, all right. I done it. And they say, well, how you did it? And I say, man, I don't fucking know. And pop, it hit me again. And then they start spilling over the information to me, telling me, you know, what happened or what they thought happened. And, you know, for me to repeat the shit. So they say, you did it like this, huh? And I just repeated what the fuck they said. You know what I'm saying? And for eight hours later, I go and they put me on the 10th floor trying to say I was fucking crazy. You know what I'm saying? After they whipped my ass and trying to find out where the dope was, when I didn't give it up, they just pinned me to the fucking murder. You know? And that shit for me was crazy, because once I came down and was, you know, in a clear state of mind, I was like, oh, fuck, what the fuck I'd have done? And then my lawyer came to me, and he was like, listen. He looked at me first, and he took pictures, and he was like, oh, shit, they beat me, you know, this and that. And so I was like, bruh. I said, man, he said, you know, he asked me, did I do it? And I said, man, no, I didn't. I said, listen, they beat the shit out of me. They fucking made me say certain shit. So with that said, he produced a report of what happened. So once I saw what happened on this report that he was telling me, the shit didn't link up, because they didn't even know what the crime scene was like, because they was fresh on the, you know, they didn't even stay there and investigate or whatever and get the whole gist of the story. So when I found out, I'm like, God damn, all this shit, you know, so my story didn't match up with what the fuck they made me say. You know what I'm saying? So for me, you know, after all of that shit and we going to trial and shit, man, I thought I was done for, because this, you got police involved, you got, you know, all kind of shit happening. So I just thought I was done. I was like, fuck, man, I'm going to prison for the rest of my life for some shit I ain't do. I say all the different shit I done in my life and you know, kind of got away with for street shit, and I get popped for something like this, some shit I did do, and I'm about to go to penitentiary for this? No, it's not about to happen. So my lawyer, you know, we did work shit out, and we went on ahead and started getting the fucking case together, because I wasn't home. My fucking, you know, they found a couple of different fibers of hair and different shit on the scene, you know, and the way they described the crime, man, I'd have been covered in fucking blood. You understand what I'm saying? So they took me straight to the police station. So for me, man, look, this is a big fucking deal. So you can understand how many, throughout the, you know, history of my life, all those years of walking around with, you know, holding on to some shit that I didn't do and never spoke on it and was just living my life, but still running across situations where people were saying, oh, that's that motherfucker who did this. You know what I'm saying? Because I never spoke on it. So they was fed one-sided information. You know what I'm saying? First of all, I found not guilty. They didn't have no fucking evidence. They didn't have nothing on me because I wasn't even home. I was somewhere else doing some other shit. So
you had a rock solid alibi then?
Well, yeah, the alibi was rock solid, but if I would have told them actually what I was doing, they probably would have arrested me for that shit. But it was a rock solid alibi because people saw me and other people knew that I wasn't fucking home. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I wasn't even there. Even the brother, even he, you know, he came downstairs and he said I wasn't there. But then when it got to the courtroom, he did something different. You know what I'm saying? It was kind of weird to me because first he was in my corner, and then next thing I know, he get in the courtroom and start saying some other shit. But I understand because this your people, and I get it. I'm not mad with that dude or nothing. I ain't got no problems with you. Regardless of what you have against me, I'm not going to bash you. I'm not going to do none of that. But it just tripped me out to see that in the courtroom that you went another way after, you know, what was said. And
see, guys, the thing that I like about Damon Neville is that he can tell his side of the story, and he tells a story that you can imagine. Mystical told a blatant lie on Vlad TV. He dressed it up and made it look pretty. He said that they were private. Damon Neville and Michelle Tyler were private in their home. But then Mystical said on one of his films that Damon Neville came in his house and lied. So if he lived there, how is it just your house if they were so private and they had a petition? Like I said, guys, Damon Neville told a real story versus what Mystical told to Vlad TV about the incident regarding his sister's murder and Damon Neville. Damon Neville expressed many and abundance of information, wealth of information. He even stated that his lawyer took pictures of his injuries after he was beaten by the police. But Mystical stated to Vlad that Damon Neville, because he is, and I did not say this in any of my video, guys, Damon Neville is the nephew of the Neville Brothers R&B singers. And Mystical claims at that time that that family was very protected. Now, what I like about Damon Neville is that he has receipts, because this can be pulled up and he can get that information and show that to the public that he was in fact beaten by the police into confessing into Michelle Tyler's murder. Mystical has no receipts. He just has words. Thank you guys for watching this video. Please like, share, and comment on the video. It means a lot to me. And thank you guys for taking the time to watch. I will be back with part two, Into the Mind of Mystical Michael Tyler. Until the next video, guys. Bye.